Hi, I'm Bruce Goldstein. I'm discussing technology transfer, and in this segment, I'm going to be talking about trademarks and trade secrets. So, some basics first on trademarks. A trademark is any word, phrase, logo, symbol, shape, number, letter, color, sound, scent, or other device or combination. If I've missed anything under the sun, please let me know. That, and this is the important part, serves to identify the source of specific products and to distinguish them from similar stuff sold by others. If you only learn one thing about trademarks, it's that underlined portion. If you say, all right, which outcome better serves this function, that's the outcome that almost certainly is going to be the right one. Once again, you can't trademark a patent. So functional and purely descriptive elements can't be used as part of a mark. Now, in the United States, there are some treaties that allow for international trade. Big companies like to have only one set of rules, but the reality is trademarks, since they are so language dependent, are still very nation dependent. But in the United States, there are four types of marks. The first is a trademark, notice the space, that covers goods, service mark for services. And then there are two strange ones. This first, a collective mark, which is saying we are part of a group that offers a particular product or service. So Sunkist, for example, would be the citrus growers in Southern California. AAA is the Automobile Association in the United States. Those are a series of garages that perform automotive services. And then there are certification marks. This is a mark that's owned by one party, like a government, but used by a company in their marketing of their products as a seal of we met this basic threshold of location or quality or some other criteria set by the certificate mark owner. So for those who are familiar with Underwriter Laboratories, that UL shows up on light bulbs and other pieces of equipment. Underwriter Laboratories is a nonprofit, and they will test various products that are made by others. And when they get that stamp, then the seller of that product, say Philips, can then mark its light bulbs with the UL mark. Now, I hadn't really mentioned, I did mention briefly the C in a circle for copyrights. There also is a P in a circle for patents, R in a circle for trademarks, and you also see TM or SM for a service mark. So what's the deal with it? Well, for patents and copyrights, yeah, there are rules for how you do it and consequences for when you don't, but for trademarks, it's huge. If you go to the trademark part of the patent and trademark office, and convince them that, yes, you have the exclusive right to use that mark. You're the only one in the United States using that mark in that product in that context, and no one would be confused with that. Once the trademark office registers your mark, you get some very powerful rights. So the rights, however, the trademark rights don't come necessarily right away. I think I'm going to be getting to that just in a little bit. They come from your actual use of the mark in commerce. So the customers are seeing your mark and they're recognizing it's associated with your product. Well, while you're waiting for that registration to happen, you might or might not actually have a trademark. You might own it, but you don't know. So the TM and the SM, they're placeholders. They're warnings to the public saying, hi, I think this mark is a valid mark, and I'm trying to enforce it. I will enforce it if you try and copy it. But that's all it is. Now, if you have the R in a circle and you don't have the registration, some very bad things can happen. It's not important, but it is a big deal in trademarks, where it's not as much of a big deal in copyrights and patents. So why do we get a mark? What's the purpose of it? Well, the function, as I said in the beginning of this talk, is to protect the consumer's ability to identify the source. And there's this quote that is often used, and I think it's a very good one. easily identified trademarks reduce the costs consumers incur in searching for what they desire. The lower the cost of the search, the more competitive the market. And you think about it, go into a supermarket, walk down, say, the soap aisle, and you have a conversation in your brain, something like this. You know, the last time I got Safeguard, I got a rash, and I just don't like the scent of Irish Spring, so I'm going to get something mild. How about I try Ivory? Think about what you just did. You used trademarks as a substitute for actual market research. Now imagine walking down that same aisle and seeing bin after bin of unidentified soaps. In order to figure out which one to buy, you'd pretty much have to wash your hands with each and every soap. So the trademarks helped you. It made your searching much more efficient. You got the product you wanted, and the company gets the benefit of the sale. It's also a quality assurance measure or proxy for goodwill. So love them or hate them, you know what you get when you walk into a McDonald's. But if you walked into a McDonald's and saw rats skittering around the floor, you're not going into any McDonald's anywhere. So you're going to be very careful about the quality of your product, that it at least meets certain specific standards. Don't necessarily have to be great standards, but they are at least something that the market knows. If I walk into a McDonald's, I know what I'm going to get. And finally, you hear about things like, say, McDonald's going after a guy who hung out a shingle out in Wichita, Kansas. He happens to be named McDonald's, but he calls it the McDonald's Law Firm. And you say, why on earth would McDonald's, the restaurant, the Golden Arches people, be going after somebody like that? Why can't he call the business by his own name? You'd think that. But the reality is, let's say that McDonald's just simply ignores it. And they ignore the McDonald's dry cleaner, and the McDonald's this, and the McDonald's that. And sooner or later, you find the McDonald's hash browns in the freezer section of your local grocery store. Is it from the Golden Arches or not? You might easily mistake it. The power of the mark has been diluted. And so you, as the mark owner, actually have a duty to go out into the marketplace and pay attention to what other marks are out there. And if you fail to do that, you risk losing your mark. And it's important to note, for each of these three policies, the point of the policy is to benefit the marketplace. It isn't to benefit the mark owner. If the mark owner does a good job of keeping that mark distinctive and making sure that they're the only ones using it, then the consumers get the benefit of the strength of that mark, the power of it to identify the source of the particular goods or services. So I'm going to transition now to trade secrets. This is a very brief section because it tends not to be particularly important for the tech transfer environment, but it is important to understand what they are and what the basic rules are. So in the United States, trade secret, there really isn't federal trade secrets. There are a few that talk about economic espionage and the like, but for the most part, this is a creature of state law, meaning that what rules and what rights apply to your trade secret depend on where you are and where the theft occurred. So you have to actually know the nuances of that state's laws. But there's an effort to try and harmonize them. There's something called the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, which actually isn't a law in and of itself. Basically, a bunch of academics got together and some lawyers and companies got together, and they said, this is what we think is a good structure of a trade secret statute. And then they started passing it out to various states and saying it would be a really good idea if you use this as your model. And most of the states did, in fact, use that as their starting point, but they all tweaked it based upon their own unique politics. Plus, you had all the courts that are interpreting all these subtle differences, so you still have nuances. For the purposes of today's talk, this is very generic. It is basically any information that is secret in fact, and when we talk about secret in fact, it's not an absolute secret all around the world. What it means is your competitor would have a really hard time finding it if they went looking for it. It has to have economic value. In other words, it either improves your profits or saves you costs, or it just would be very expensive to regenerate or reverse engineer. Reverse engineering, by the way, perfectly legal, as long as you don't take the information from another source. And the usually where people get tripped up is this last bullet. The owner has to take steps that are reasonable under the circumstances to keep it secret. And where people usually screw up when you start looking at the cases is because they were lazy, sloppy, careless. They didn't really put a lot of effort into truly protecting their trade secrets. So you hear about senior vice presidents blabbing in an airport lounge at a conference when, sure enough, the competition is sitting at the same bar and they overhear the conversation. But it also happens when you have a collaboration, a scientific collaboration, and the company comes to you and says, oh, everything we discuss is trade secret. Really? The sports? The latest weather? The news of the day? No, I'm sorry, not everything is a trade secret. If you're going to claim that something is a trade secret, at the very least, you have to be able to identify which specific piece of information has that economic value. You got to be able to tell people, no, this is my trade secret. If you can't be bothered to do just that and train your employees, I'm sorry, I'm really not sympathetic. Oh, it's so hard to get our scientists to mark everything confidential that's truly confidential. Yeah, too bad. Because if you can't be bothered, if you don't see it as valuable enough to fire them for revealing your secrets, that's your problem. It clearly wasn't valuable enough. And why should, for trade secret purposes, the public doesn't benefit from your having a trade secret, so why should anyone else be held to a higher standard protecting your secrets than you impose on yourself? So it is very much a disfavored form of intellectual property. In order to get protection to it, the very first thing you have to show is somebody did a bad act. So it's misappropriation or unfair competition or something along those lines. You are, when you claim that trade secret, you are the white knight and they are the black knight, so to speak. Now, there are a few traps about trade secrets. The first is this concept of insider trading. Most people think of insiders as the members of the board, the C-suite people. Turns out it's a heck of a lot broader than that. An insider is somebody who has information that could affect the price of the stock, how traders buy and sell stock on an open market. And there are an awful lot of cases where, for example, I'm going to tweak these facts, but it's pretty close to what actually happened. A scientist comes home, says, they're having dinner with a family party. And the scientist says, yeah, things are pretty bad. I just got the clinical results. It's going to kill the drug. Well, brother-in-law is sitting at the table, understands the significance of that information, goes out and sells his shares in the stock and avoids a huge loss. Well, even if you come back and try and go after the trader, the son, brother-in-law, whoever, yeah, you can get that person, but you can also get the person who did the revealing, the scientist who was sloppy and didn't protect that information. That's called tipping. And it's related to insider trading. There have been a number of instances where people who work in clinical laboratories or in the FDA or the patent office did this and ended up going to jail or at least paying a very large civil fine. For the United States government in particular, and for most state governments, there's something called the Freedom of Information Act. The Freedom of Information Act says if you have a record and the government is possession of a record, that is presumptively releasable to the public unless the government can demonstrate it falls into one of the exceptions. One of those exceptions is the Freedom of Information Act. Is the trade secret. If we can identify that, yes, this is something that is a trade secret or is commercially valuable information that we got from a company, we have a duty to protect it. And if we don't take steps to protect it, if we reveal it, that potentially is a crime. So it's important to know, even if it isn't something that would affect insider trading, we have a duty to protect that trade secret, which we just happen to be, we happen to have it in our possession. I hope you found this information useful. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, please contact the program coordinator.